Hello, my name is Pedro Silva Girão, and for this conference on teaching, education, and learning, I propose you the subject of engineering education in the 21st century. First of all, a word of why I choose this subject. Back into 2001, when I had to prepare a course on sensors and actuators for the master degree in electrical and computer engineering, I felt that first, the type of classes that were usually lectured were unsuited for the purpose I wanted to attain. I wanted that the students could basically profit from my experience on the subject, and everything should be organized towards that objective. And I felt then, as I feel today, that we should be changing from teaching to learning. So education based on the student and not on the teacher, on the professor. Now, if we look back and until now, engineer education, as other types of university education, did not change much in the last centuries since the beginning of universities in Europe. And things did not change because until recently, knowledge was basically in people's minds and on books. So these were the two sources, let's say, of knowledge. And so the transmission of this knowledge had to be done either by contacts between the apprentice and the master at the beginning, or student and teacher, if we want. Nowadays, and this included practice aspects or by book reading. So these were the two means of transmission of knowledge. Now, if we look to what is happening and what happens already now, and we answer the question, where is knowledge nowadays? I'd say that knowledge is everywhere, everywhere in the sense that it's no longer only in people and on books. It is spread, and we know that spread, namely around the internet, around the world of data and some information. I think that globalization and the technical developments, more recent ones in particular, have positive and negative aspects. One very positive, and perhaps in my opinion, one of the most important positive aspects of globalization is related to the access to data and to information. And I make the separation between data and information because they are not exactly the same. Information in many cases requires some processing, some data processing. But it is amazing, we all know that how we can get to data and some information nowadays. This is something very extraordinary, in my opinion. Another point that I think positive that happened in this millennium already is the Bologna Agreement. So the Bologna process that involved European countries, and one of the main output of this process, in my opinion, one of the positive outputs of this process is that education became centered in students, so in learning instead of teaching. Okay. Now, okay, so information nowadays is, and knowledge is spread all over. So it is easier to assess knowledge. So I think that a new paradigm is needed for engineer education. And when we think about this paradigm, we must answer two questions. First, what to learn? Because this implies, obviously, the definition of the curricula, of the curriculum of each specialization of engineering, and how to learn. So how to organize, conduct the, in this case, learning process. I want to be talking about teaching process, but rather the learning process. And namely, thinking of the type of classes that we think should serve better our purposes. Now, thinking a little about the curriculum, I think that at least for the moment, for the next years, and nobody knows exactly what the future will bring us in 20, 25 years, even in the engineering area, I think that this remains basic, important to subject students to basic formation, basic training on maths, physics, and informatics. This is for engineering is crucial. Of course, in each specialty, there are basic and advanced topics that must be addressed, and it is important to organize also these two levels of knowledge transmission. And finally, I think a subject I think important to take in consideration when thinking and preparing curricula is to have in mind that we are preparing someone to be in the, to have a professional life, so be working in the future, and for he or she to have success, they must have acquired some soft skills. They must be very good, namely on teamwork, on oral, on written communication and reporting, only to give a couple of examples. But also they must be, engineers must be cultivated people. So they must have sensitivity and some knowledge about humanities, arts, and social sciences. Of course, if I think a little back, I would say that in the, I won't say good old days, because days can be both good in the past or good in the present, in the future, hopefully in the future also. But past generations, and I'm included in this definition, I would say that we were somehow prepared in these domains of humanities, arts, and social sciences a little in high school. Nowadays, perhaps the preparation is not so keen, and so the answer we must ask is, should we at the university, should we correct for this, should we complement what young people knows and is sensitive to this kind of subjects? Well, my answer is perhaps, okay. The learning paradigm, a little about first type of classes. Okay, classical, there are other types, seminars and so forth, which are possibilities to consider. But classically, we know that courses work basically supported on lectures, practical sessions, and labs. Are they all important? Should we keep them all? Well, I think that lectures basically for those basic formation subjects like maths, physics, and the basics of specialty courses, they remain important. And probably there are no alternative nowadays, especially when we think about the number of students that integrate some courses, some degrees. Of course, it is difficult to find efficient solutions for when we think about hundreds of students. In what concerns practical sessions, here I would say that it depends on what they are for. Clearly, I would say no if the purpose is to train mechanically students by solving recipes. I would say that for this, no. Labs, of course, are fundamental. So labs in engineering are crucial. You can learn engineering, most of things of engineering at home, but labs are, in most cases, are impossible to get the experience of working in the subject by being at home. So labs are fundamental in engineering education, whatever the specialty is. Okay, looking into what we can do about learning program. We first solution is to keep the current model. But the current model, in my opinion, if we choose this way of proceeding, we should probably skip the lecture practical type of classes and have a mixed of the both, what I call a lecture and practice. That would be a dynamic session where problems would be discussed between professors and students, and which should serve to clarify theories, concepts, techniques of one or more curricular units. So, lecture practical in one. Labs. Of course, they are to keep, but I would say that it is important that labs work on the basis of objectives are defined for each lab session or sessions, and the means to do the experimental work are provided. This done, it is up to the students to prepare what they will have to do and to do it on the lab. So, learning, education centered on the student. Another possibility is changing the model and looking for a model where learning is by doing. And learning by doing can be achieved by the participation of students in projects, in specific tasks with specific objectives. This type of solution, the participation in projects, which is not new, there are some schools that have already implemented at least some part of their teaching programs following this idea. I have some positive points. I think they are extremely motivating for students. They are well adapted to young people's way of learning, in my opinion, and they are an excellent way to prepare for professional life because they promote teamwork, they promote integration of knowledge, and they force, in a certain way, students to look into things from a macro point of view, but also from a micro, from the global approach to the project and also from the analysis of the particular problems to solve. This learning by doing has naturally some problems without aiming at being exhaustive, I would point out two. One is the implementation, and they are major problems, I would say. One is the implementation. If you are talking about projects for a lot of students, we would have to have a large number of different projects with different complexities, and probably we would have to change projects each 3 years, or probably every year would start a new project. So this would require a lot, I would say, of imagination and material resources and logistics that are not trivial at all. Another problem of this learning by doing paradigm is that it is very heavy for the teaching staff. So what we are talking here is something similar to what is done with PhD students. One way of solving the problem with teaching staff, one possible solution, is perhaps grouping students of all years of the program. So if we are talking a BSc, I would say students for all the 3 years, making groups with a certain number of students of each year, and associating to these groups teaching staff, professors, to number of professors according to the project that would supervise all activities. And these groups would work not only to take the project to a good end, but also older students would participate in the evaluation of younger ones, which would reduce the stress over the teaching staff. This is nothing new. We all know that in many countries, namely PhD students, participate in the evaluation of BSc or MSc students. So this is nothing very new. In conclusion, I would say that engineering education nowadays seems inadequate for the present and future preparation of engineers. I think that something has to be done to adequate education to the needs and to young people's way of learning. Of course, in what concerns the needs, I think that nobody can answer positively, or at least I would say can have a high degree of certainty of what will be engineering in 20, 30 years. I personally don't know what engineers will have to do or will be doing in 30 years. I don't know. Of course, we have to do something, so we have to have some assumptions to lead us. And in that direction, I would say that we must assume now that the situation, at least in the short term, 5-10 years, will not change very much. But really, nobody knows exactly what will happen. And so basically, I think that some has to be done. As I mentioned, the model that I forward as a possible solution or for organizing group of students basically brings to the first and second cycle, so to BSc and to MSc's, the learning process of PhD students, but obviously we are talking about a total different number of people involved, of students namely. So as I mentioned, it's not trivial. But Personally, I think that something really has to be done. So, thank you very much for watching, and until the next opportunity. Goodbye.